On your 2017 Flagstaff 21FBRS, the very first thing you'll want to do when you get to the campground is you always want to get your camper level side to side first. And to do that, you'll probably use some blocks and whatnot under the actual tires. Some people will use the Lynx leveling blocks. Some people will just use actual pieces of wood. You'll want to get it level side to side. Then once you unhook your weight distribution hitch, now you're going to be able to use your tongue jack here to get it level front to back. Once that's done, you will put all four of your stabilizing jacks down. Once they touch the ground, you'll be able to put about another half a crank on them, and all that's going to do is it's going to take the shimmy out of your camper. I know you've had some campers before, but what you're going to have here is your two propane tanks. When I have one of my propane tanks on, this has an actual valve, a little indicator arrow, that now when I run out of propane on this, this indicator, where it's actually green, will turn red. Once that happens, I'll be able to turn this tank off, flip over to my tank on this side, and then run off this tank. Now, some people, if you know you're getting low on one of your tanks, and you know your other one is full, but say it's you're running your furnace at night and it's the fall and I don't want to run out of propane in the middle of the night, what you can do is leave both tanks on, and to get you by for a few extra hours, I can put this arrow right down in the middle. Now what it's going to do is pull off of both tanks. However, you always have to remember, if you ever do that, when you run out of propane, you're out for good. So now you're going to have to take both bottles and have them repaired. That's why I always recommend run off one tank or the other, but it's nice knowing that, hey, if this is getting low and I didn't realize it and it's 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock at night, I can't get somewhere, I'm gonna be able to go somewhere else. Right behind us as well, guys, is we do have our 12 volt battery. That's gonna power certain things like your lights, your different lights inside, the stereo inside, lights on the exterior of the camper, for example, your light that's on the front. We call this our hitch light. But what a lot of people end up using it for, instead of just using it for hooking up at nighttime, is when you back this camper into your campsite, if you're ever chopping wood at night, hey, now I don't have to play the flashlight under the net game. I can actually turn this light on here and split some wood. Or if you know, hey, I'm unloading something out of the vehicle or the truck, this will illuminate the front part of your camper. Next thing we have, guys, is we do have a front window. No, the front window doesn't open. Although we get that question a lot. And it does have the built-in rock guard. Guys, on the front side of your camper as well, if you come right around this way, actually, if you come right over here, you're gonna notice, guys, where this does have a on-off switch. It's almost like being in your vehicle. It's actually got a key. And what that is that's your battery disconnect. Okay. What you'll notice right now, that is in the on position. If I take this here and turn it to the up position, now all of a sudden, now there is no power to the inside of my camper that's pulling off of my battery. I'm plugged in, so there are still lights on the inside, but as soon as I unplug, absolutely zero power is being pulled from that battery at all. Okay. So that's something you just got to make sure that if you get camping somewhere and you go turn the lights on, always make sure that you have your battery switch on in the on position and that it's running. Okay. So when you turn that off, what that means is anytime you're plugged in, your battery's charging. If I'm in the off position, and I'm plugged in, my battery's not going to be charging at all because there's no current going to it. Solar panel ready. You can buy different panels that'll hook into here. It's great if you're doing a lot of primitive type camping. If you're out in the mountains somewhere, what it does is it's basically a trickle charger that during the daylight hours, that sun will actually charge that battery back up. At night, you'll use the battery, use it for lights, use it for your water pump, maybe use it for your stereo. Then all of a sudden the sun comes up the next day, your battery's almost completely drained. Now all of a sudden, hey, now I'm gonna charge that battery back up. So it's great for people that are doing more primitive camping. We actually have a city water connection, guys. This city water connection, what you'll do is you'll actually take the hose, hook the hose up to your campsite, and bring this right here and hook your hose in. That's where you're gonna actually get water and pull it from a separate source. This does not fill your fresh water tank at all. This is actually gonna bypass your tank and just run off their water alone. The next thing we have next to it, this is my city water fill tank. So what I would do is actually take a hose, stick the hose in here, and there's a couple ways you can go about actually looking at how am I getting full in the tank. You can have someone stand inside and watch the monitor panel, because right on the monitor panel, it'll show you the levels as that tank starts to fill up. And once it gets to completely full, you can yell to the person, whoever's outside, hey, you're good to turn it off. The best way from what we found And what 99% of people do, I'm sorry, stick the hose in here, turn the hose on. When the hose goes shooting out of here like a bottle rocket, you know it's full. The next thing we have is our antifreeze inlet. This antifreeze inlet, this is what's gonna keep you from having to carry antifreeze actually into your camper during the winterization progress. Like we talked about, your camper is winterized right now. But what you will do is actually take a length of hose, and usually if you have an old garden hose that's laying around the garage, you're getting ready to throw away, you'll take that garden hose, hook it on here, cut a length that will go down to the ground, all the way down to the ground, and maybe leave yourself an extra foot or so to play with. So what I would do is take my antifreeze bottle. I'm gonna put that down on the ground, hook my hose in here. The first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna actually go to the backside of my hot water heater. And like I said, you can do that right behind here. You're gonna take these two screws out, this panel is gonna turn away, and it'll actually have two valves that you'll see in there. And what you're gonna wanna do is actually flip those valves, and that's what's gonna allow that antifreeze to bypass your hot water heater now. So you're not getting antifreeze into your hot water heater, but still allow that water to go through the plumbing in the camper. So now that's when I'm gonna go and I'm actually gonna turn my faucets on, I'm gonna turn my shower on, I'm gonna turn my bathroom sink on. Even you'll have to come outside and turn your outside shower on. And you'll just run that until the antifreeze actually comes out of those faucets. Once that's done, the next step of the process is, we were talking earlier about those low point drains, which I'll show you again here in a minute. That's where you're gonna allow that antifreeze to get out of there. So while you're running antifreeze is basically to get it in all the lines, but all the plumbing, it's making sure that you get antifreeze in any dips and dives that are actually in those lines so that that's sitting in there and not water.
Let me ask you a question about that antifreeze. Is it you mix it with water or is it straight?
Straight antifreeze. And it's biodegradable. It's fine if you ever, say you got a little bit in your tank at one point in time and you go to drink some water. Again, you're gonna flush it out the best you can, but it's not gonna harm you if you had a little bit in like a glass of water or something. It's not gonna harm you at all. And then something else, I'm glad you brought that up. Something else that you can do is, it doesn't hurt that once everything's ran, take that antifreeze and pour a little bit down your drains too, so that it gets caught in the traps. I know you're gonna be running your faucets, but again, once it's all done, typically what people will do is take a rag and they'll wipe their sink clean. Before you do that, maybe dump a little bit down in those traps just to ensure that, hey, I got a little bit of some stuff in there.
Okay.
Moving on from there, guys, you do have your storage, and the storage is gonna go all the way through. Right here, we have our hot water heater. It is a 6-gallon gas and electric hot water heater. Now, it does have two master reset circuit breakers right here that you can push if you ever had to reset it. And if you look down here, you're gonna notice there's a small piece of white tape down there, guys. And there's a switch. And this switch is actually right now, it's in the on position, now it's gonna be in the off position. That switch, that's how you turn on the electric side of your hot water heater. So right now, with that switch being off, it's only gonna run on gas. I typically recommend to our customers to run on the gas side. The reason being is, everyone gets in a routine when they're actually setting their camper up. If I'm inside getting everything set up, and say you happen to be outside and you're hooking your hoses up, maybe you don't have the water hose hooked up yet, but you're getting stuff ready to go and you flip that hot water heater switch. Well, for whatever reason, if I don't have water in it yet, the hot water heater, it takes a little time for it to warm up. So as long as you're on the gas side, it still gives you that extra minute, 2 minutes to get the hose hooked up. If it's on the electric side, if there's no water in it, it instantly burns the element. So you always wanna make sure that, hey, the water is hooked up. And again, it's up to you. If you wanna run it on the electric side, absolutely fine. But the gas side is what I call a little more forgiving. Again, guys, we have more storage under here. As we move around this way, we do have our outside shower. Again, nothing real fancy you need to know about the outside shower, guys, other than it's a great thing for washing dishes. It's great for washing the family dog. It does have a hot and a cold side as well. And then this cord will actually, all your hose just feeds right in the box. The handle lays in there, and then you do actually lock it up. As we move around, the next thing we have here is we have our cable and satellite hookup right under here. And over here we have our black tank flush. The black tank flush, what that's gonna be is, you've had campers before, you're familiar with how to dump it. Again, you always wanna dump on your dump valve. What you're gonna do is take your hose here and hook your hose up. you will actually always want to drain your big pipe first. The big pipe is what we call the black tank. Black tank is anything that goes down the stool. After that's done, now I'll go ahead and I will dump my gray tank. The easiest way I can tell people, because these handles aren't going to hold their color forever, excuse me, by looking at the pipe itself, that's a great indicator for which one is which. Gray tank is sink water, shower water, and then bathroom sink water. Big pipe, black tank, only the toilet only. So once both of those are completely drained, what you can do now for this black tank flush is actually take a hose and hook your hose to this. And while you're at the dump station, leave both of those valves open. And what this is going to do is it's only in your black tank, but it's actually like having a sprinkler system that's built into there. And what it's going to do is it helps knock all that stuff that might be built up on the side of your tank that might have some kind of odor to it or anything like that, especially in the summer months when it's really hot and this thing's sitting on the side of your garage. It's not a bad idea. Hey, use this. Make sure you're getting all that stuff out of your tank, and it just helps you keep your tank cleaner. But also another reason they do that is it helps the monitors, the sensors that are in that tank, it helps them stay clean so that your monitor panel on the inside will be a little bit more accurate. The next thing we have is a power cord. The one thing that's a little different, guys, about these campers now, there's no more feeding this thing back in and pulling the cord out where you're gonna get your knuckles all bloody. However, it is a twist lock plug. So what you have to do is this plug will actually plug into your camper. It plugs in, and what you'll notice is it plugs in, the light is on, but you need to turn the whole plug, and then it's got a collar that locks that down in place. Okay. And what that does now is once that's locked in place, now this plug can't come out.
Okay.
It's locked in place. Right. When you're done camping, you reverse the process. Undo the collar, remove the whole cord, and then it's got that leather carrying case we were showing you earlier to put the cord in. Next thing we have, guys, is you do have these caps on either end of the bumper. These caps come off. That's where I'm gonna store my sewer hose. Always give them a little pound, make sure they're nice and tight. Matching spare tire, guys. Right in here is what we have. This is the back side of my refrigerator. I know we haven't been inside and gone over the refrigerator yet, but on the back side of my refrigerator, you are gonna have the overflow hose. So from time to time, you're gonna be out camping, you're gonna notice that there's water that's just running down this and running onto the ground. It's nothing to be alarmed about. Literally all that is condensation. However, these two little tabs here, usually if you have like a dime, a nickel, anything like that, you can turn these tabs, or even a car key works. What you'll wanna do is from time to time, I'm gonna pop this off. And all I'm doing when I pop this off, all I'm doing is taking a look on the inside here. By taking a look on the inside, what this is showing me that, hey, I don't have any bird debris, there's no mouse droppings in there, because from time to time, exactly, wasps, because this is an open grate. Again, this is an open grate, and just like your hot water heater, this is gonna omit a little bit of a propane smell. The wasps and insects absolutely love that smell. So all this is doing is it's just something that you can do that's a real quick thing just for general maintenance, and something you can check from time to time, because it's something you can check whether you're at the campground or if it's just sitting in your driveway at home, and it only takes a minute. As we move around, you're gonna notice it does have the two outside speakers, and then also our porch light. There is a reason that the porch light, guys, is an amber lens. That amber lens does not attract any bugs versus having just a regular clear lens. Next thing we have here is on the inside, when you actually have your range, your exhaust range for over your burners, there are two tabs here that you will lift up, and now this is going to allow my exhaust to vent out. From time to time, if you ever get in your camper and you go to boil water, you boil water, you turn the fan on, and you think to yourself, oh my gosh, this isn't taking out any exhaust at all. What is going on? That's your first red light, or first thing that should pop up is, hey, I better go outside and make sure that these are open.
Show me how to open that again.
Actually, what you'll do is just take this tab and push up, take that tab and push up. So they're latched down. Yep, you just gotta take them and push up. Going on from there, the bracket we have here, this is a bracket that I will actually be able to take my TV from inside, unplug the power and the cable hookup, bring it outside and set it right here. And then I have my cable hookup, which is gonna run to my top antenna, as well as two power outlets as well. The next thing we have here is the furnace. These are the vents for the furnace. again, same thing as you do with the refrigerator. I would strongly suggest getting what we call mud dauber screens, and you can actually put those mud dauber screens right on these, and again, it keeps the wasps and all the insects from going in here and getting into the backside of your furnace and making a nest. You can get those same screens as well for your hot water heater. Something else I always warn my customers about to keep in the back of their mind. When you're camping, most of your meals are done outside. Doesn't matter if it's spring, summer, or fall. When you're camping, a lot of the times, like when we used to go, we would set our picnic table up or our table right outside here so that you were under the awning, you were in the shade. One thing to keep in mind is if you're eating a meal or you're just hanging out playing a board game, if your furnace is running on the inside, this is going to emit a strong odor of propane that, again, you might not notice it when you're outside, but all of a sudden, if you start getting a headache or you start getting a little dizzy, that's something you want to keep in mind. If you're running your furnace frequently, I wouldn't want to be sitting here having my cup of coffee in the morning and hanging out by my furnace. Just something to keep in mind. If you know you're running it, again, you don't have to stay away from it all the time when it's running. Just something to be cautious of. Again, your gas grill here, guys. The gas grill, it is pre-plumbed in our camper. The next thing I want to go over is the awning. We kind of played with that a little bit earlier. But the awning, guys, awning, I'm going to take it all the way in, and then I'm going to bring it all the way back out. You'll notice it is a faster motor than some of our other competitors that are out there. So that you're completely in. No locking mechanisms, nothing you're going to need to do. When I go to bring this awning out, I'm going to extend the awning.
Is it all marked what you've got there?
Absolutely. It's marked awning extend and then awning retract. So extend's taking it out, retract will bring it back in. But typically, like we talked about earlier, I'm going to take my awning all the way out. Once it's completely out, I'm then going to bring it in maybe about a quarter of the way so that I actually have my flap. I want my flap to be facing straight up and down. By doing so, it's going to give you a little extra shade here, but it also pulls that fabric nice and tight. Now, as long as you're standing there, if you wouldn't mind on this top piece here, we can actually take this top piece and pull it down. And then there's this little tab here that I can screw that tight.
Okay. Hang it one side
over the other. There it is. So now, this is just going to give you guys, it'll give you a little bit more shade if you wanted it, but also I can do one side or another at different times. If it's starting to rain, I want to run my rainwater that way, I can do it. If you want to let that side up and bring this side down, you can. If you don't want it to be quite, say it's really starting to rain pretty good and you just need that extra shelter, now I can tip that one up just a little bit. So there's multiple different combinations. As soon as we come in the door, the first thing we have is our fire extinguisher. So that fire extinguisher, if you ever needed to get to it, guys, open the door, it's always going to be right here. The next thing we have is our screen door. To open the screen door, we come out. If you want to open the screen door, you'll take this little tab here, the plastic tab, push down on it, now it's going to open up. So, but when it closes, you're going to notice I can't get to my handle. Now I can get to my handle here. Also, say if the wind's howling, what you're going to notice, we have what we call pinchless tension hinges on my door. You can't open this door and it would have to be blowing hurricane force winds to rip this thing out of your hand and open it up. So it's supposed to be tight like that. The only time you have to be careful is when you're shutting the door behind you. Don't just shut the door and think it's going to latch. You kind of have to give it a little oomph to get that to latch. Okay. Right down here, this is the vent for my furnace. You have one on this side of the cabinet, one on the other side. This is where my heat's going to come out.
Okay.
So a lot of times what you want to do, keep in mind, you might want the air blowing down, but typically what people are going to want, you're going to want this so that the heat is blowing this direction. Okay. We used to do it a lot of times when we were camping in the fall. You're hanging out under the awning. Yeah, it's a little chilly out, but maybe you're watching the game. You're not necessarily going to have the door closed here. Maybe someone's inside cooking some food and you want to have a conversation. I can have this door closed and turn this around and have this vent blowing warm air out this direction now. So, and again, it's not, it's you're heating the outside. But if someone's standing here watching the game, it's just a little tip you can use just to kind of keep yourself kind of comfortable. Moving to the monitor panel. The first light we have is our interior light.
Okay.
So when you come in, and we had talked earlier how you go push all the lights, what you'll be able to do is I'll flip this switch, and that's going to turn my interior light on here.
Okay.
That keeps me from coming home to a completely dark camper.
Okay.
All I have to do is hit this one switch.
Okay.
The next one we have is our porch light. So this is going to be our amber light that's right outside the porch here. The next one is our scare light. The scare light is basically our awning lights.
Okay.
So you'll notice the awning lights are on, awning lights are off.
Okay.
So that's mounted in your scare light button. Now, we talked about the awning. Extend, takes my awning out. Retract, brings my awning in.
Okay.
Next thing we have is a slide out button. And slide out. I will bring my slide out in. And that's just with a push of a button. And again, we'll go over the slide out more when we get ready to close it up.
Okay.
The next button we have here is we have, this is going to be our monitor panel. So imagine, you're out at the campground. When you're out at the campground and you want to be able to say, hey, I want to check the battery. We've been without power. Maybe the campground lost power. We've been without power or we're primitive camping. What do we have left? I can push on the battery button and it'll show me how much charge I have left. The next thing I can do is I can move up with one switch, and it's actually to my fresh water tank. You'll notice right now, your fresh water tank is empty. Moving up to my black, the black tank, it's now empty. Thank goodness, that would have been bad news. The next one we have is our gray tank. Gray tank is anything, again, down the sink and down the bathroom sink and the kitchen, and I'm sorry, the shower stall itself. That's going to be your gray tank. Black tank was, again, anything just down the toilet. Moving over from here, we have our water pump. So you want to use your faucet or anything and you're running off the tank, you have to use the water pump. If you are running off of the city water connection, you don't have to use the water pump.
Okay.
The city water pressure is going to be enough to physically be able to feed your actual camper. The next, we have two switches here. One's for my hot water heater on the gas side. The next switch is my hot water heater on the electric side. Now, do you remember what I told you about the switch on the hot water heater outside?
We got it. We got the electric part shut off.
Exactly. So if you want to switch your electric side, there's two precautions to it now. You have the outside switch as well as my switch in here to run this on the electric side. Now, the hot water heater over here, this is running off my gas. So right now I could turn this on. My hot water heater is going to start to go. But this little light, this DSI fault light, what that is that's basically a warning light. When I go to try and heat my hot water, light my hot water heater, you're going to flip the switch on, and you're going to see this little light comes on for a couple seconds, and then it shuts off. Your hot water heater will try to light itself three different times before this DSI light will actually just stay on. And what that's telling you is, hey, my hot water heater did not light. So what I'll do is I'll come over and flip the switch off, give it about 3 seconds, and turn the switch back on. Now, the only reason a lot of times that your hot water heater might not light is because maybe it's very windy out. If you're somewhere like Jim Edgar State Park, I know some of the different campgrounds and stuff that don't have a lot of trees and stuff like around Mark Twain, if it's very, very windy, you might have to do it once or twice. And again, another thing you can do, if it is a very windy day, it's nothing more than walking over to your hot water heater, put your butt up against it for a couple seconds, because that'll keep the wind from going in there and help that thing light. But again, I probably only hear of one or two times a year from people, and typically they're camping somewhere where there's not a lot of wind block. You have to have some pretty drastic wind before it won't light. As we come around here, we're going to have our refrigerator and freezer. There's only two buttons that control it. It's very simple. Right now I have it on, and you're going to notice that it's in the auto setting. That auto setting, what it's going to do is it's saying, hey, what am I going to run off of today? Am I plugged in? Hey, I'm plugged in, whether it's plugged into your garage or a campsite. Hey, I'm plugged in. I'm ready to start cooling down. I'm going to run off electric. You come in, turn this on, and it doesn't, and it's on auto, and it's not plugged into power. Now, all of a sudden, as long as I have my propane tanks on, it's going to cool down and use propane. auto. When you're auto and hooked up to electric, this thing only probably takes a few hours to actually cool down to the point I can put food in it. Sometimes that's 4 hours, sometimes it's 6-7 hours. It just depends on how hot the camper is and how hot the actual refrigerator is. On the propane side, guys, I'll warn you, it might take a day or two, 3 days maybe, to cool it down. Because the propane, it takes so much longer. But what's nice is when you're on the auto side, right now that's pretty much you're going to use it there all the time. When this is cooled down, and say it's a Wednesday afternoon, I got my camper plugged in, I got my refrigerator cool, I went out to the store, I picked up my brats and hot dogs and hamburgers and coleslaw and everything that I want to be able to take out to the campground this weekend, hey, I can go in, put it right inside my refrigerator in my camper, and leave it plugged in until I leave. Well, Friday, when I leave after work, as soon as I unplug, again, as long as I have my propane bottle on, it's automatically going to switch over to propane, and that propane is going to maintain this temperature and this cold till you get to your campsite and get plugged back in again.
So it'll maintain it, just take it a long time.
Long time to actually cool it down, okay. But it maintains it really well.
Okay.
Also, you're going to notice in here, there's a little vent and there's this little white slide on here.
Okay.
What you can do is that's just something you can play with. That's actually what controls the temperature of a refrigerator.
Okay.
If you want it to be cooler, you slide it up. If you want it to be a little less cold, you'll slide it down.
Okay.
What a lot of people will do is when they're playing with this thing, when they're playing with their camper at home and loading stuff up, have your refrigerator going. Get it set to exactly where you want it, and maybe you'll want to put a bottle of water or something in there. If you notice, hey, my bottle of water is starting to get ice chunks in it, well, I'm going to turn the temperature down a little bit.
Okay.
So, but it's just something that you can play with. Moving down from there, we have our carbon monoxide detector, guys. If you ever had a propane leak or anything like that, typically those are going to put an alarm off. And we have our master fuse panel. Master fuse panel, everything's listed as far as what my breakers are. And what else is nice is not only do we have fuses in here, again, maybe something else you might want to add to that toolkit is a couple extra fuses. But all your fuses here. When one of these go out, guys, it does have a little light that's next to it. And that little light will show you exactly which fuse is out, so you're not playing what I call the fuse game. Starting at the bottom, or starting at the top, and it's always the last one. It's always the last one on the bottom that needs change, but you check them all at the same time. The microwave, pretty self-explanatory when it comes to a microwave. No different than what you're going to have for a microwave at home. We had talked about outside, about the range. And you do have the range light that's built into it, as well as the fan. What you'll notice now, that's open on the outside. You can actually feel it sucking this air out. If I were to go and close that vent on the outside, you'll just feel the air stirring right here. It is a 3-burner range, guys. I do not have the propane on outside, but what you'll notice, you'll come over here and you can go to the actual sparker and you can spark each individual one to light the actual burners themselves. Like we had talked about earlier, this is a glass top. Adds to your countertops. This is not a cooking top. So you always want to make sure, hey, if I'm going to be cooking, I have the glass top pushed back, folded up and pushed back, because it'll work as a grease block and stuff to keep stuff off your back window here. And then also what's nice is this is recessed in. I don't have to worry about my pans or pots or anything falling off or sliding onto my countertops. The oven, just like you would do, what you'll have is you actually have your oven control knob, which it does have a pilot light, and there's two ways you can go about it. This, you can actually light it, and what you'll want to do, you want to have a sparker because there's a little box right inside of the oven there. You'll actually be able to take your sparker or your matchstick and click that, and when it clicks, that's how you heat your oven. The burner here doesn't do it. So what a lot of people do is they'll use like a matchstick, or we've had people that'll stick a lighter back there before. Get the matchstick. It's just much easier to deal with. Moving around, the next thing I want to go over, guys, is the air conditioner. It's pretty self-explanatory. The thermostat's actually going to be right behind you here. One thing I kind of like to show people, you do have an auto setting and an on setting. Typically, what you're going to do is you're going to use your fan. You're going to leave your fan on auto. Auto means it's going to run, it'll shut off, it'll run and shut off. When you get to the campground, say this thing's been closed up all day. You got the refrigerator going. So your food's nice and cold, but you get out and you're like, oh, it's really warm. You open the windows and it's really hot outside. What I can do is make sure when you have these closed, it is forcing air out of my vents. Now, when I get to the campground, I'm going to want to open these up. And what this is, we call it a forced air dump. This is going to literally rapidly just drain, take all that cool air and rapidly cool this area down. Although it's rapidly dropping this down, it's still going to overflow some cool air to kind of pre-cool my vents. So this is going to get you comfortable before it gets the entire camper comfortable. So this is just a way you can kind of rapidly cool your camper down. Now, once I'm comfortable, now I can go ahead and shut these. And now you'll notice now it's forcing even more air out of here. Keep in mind, these are completely adjustable. You can spin these 360 degrees. If you don't want the wind, the air blowing on you, you can completely close them. Next thing you might have noticed that just came out of here, your brand new camper, I'm gonna call it snowing, because that's exactly what it does. In these Flagstaff microlights, all of my air conditioning ducts, they're all carved and routed out of styrofoam. You'll see your camper snow the first couple times you use your air conditioner. Nothing to be alarmed about. It's something that's that happens with all of them. Just pick these up and throw them away. You do have a regular fan. The fan, what you'll do is maybe you've been away from your camper and it's a gorgeous evening outside. You were in town or you were at the beach. Open your windows, turn the fan on. It's just gonna stir air around in here. Then what you can do is it's got the off, and then it's also got heat built in there as well. When you turn the heat on, the heat, as soon as I have my heat running and I go to shut it off, sometimes you have to give it 4, 5, 6, 7 minutes because it does have a cool down cycle on the actual furnace fan itself. So if you know you're packing up and leaving, turn the furnace off and make sure you know, hey, I gotta give this thing time just to make sure that, hey, my furnace fan doesn't stick on or anything like that for when I'm traveling home. You do have power outlets sporadically spread out throughout the camper to be able to plug things in. The power outlet that's actually in the bathroom, that one is a GFI outlet. So if you plug your cell phone charger in and you're wondering, well, what's going on? Why aren't any of my outlets working? They're all tied together. Always flip that switch there, that GFI switch, and make sure it just didn't trip. Sometimes if you had a curling iron that got wet or something that touched that, it might trip that breaker. We had talked about the TV, guys, and how this TV, it comes out, it swivels side to side. You're able to take this whole TV off of here, slide this up, and take this whole TV outside if you wanted to. And then it stores here for transport.
Is it like a lock or is it just...
It's just against the wall. Okay. It's actually got a very, very solid magnet on it.
Magnet.
And that magnet's what's holding it against the wall. Our cell phone charging station. And it's actually got your stereo in it as well. And the stereo, it does so many different aspects. This is an AM, FM, CD, DVD, MP3, MP4. It's got different zones, so I can turn my speakers on inside. I can have my speakers on outside, vice versa. This little stereo, it actually does so much. In the owner's pack, there's actually a nice little card and a nice little owner's packet to it. Definitely read it, because that's going to give you the best way to be able to go through and navigate each individual deal with my TV and my surround sound and outside speakers. Your mattress in your camper, guys, it is a heated mattress. This one does have that option. So actually on the end of the mattress, what you will do is plug this in and then plug this into one of your receptacles. To control your mattress, it's just like having an electric blanket that's built in. It's actually got numbers 1 through 6. 6 is gonna be the highest heat, 1 will be the lowest heat. So that's just something, it's a nice convenience to have, and it's really nice to be able to use in the spring and in the spring and fall both. When it comes to the actual bathroom, you have your shower here. Your shower is gonna have a hot and cold. One little thing I always like to show my customers is on the actual shower head, because you only have so much hot water that's in the camper, when you get it to that right temperature, I don't wanna have to play with the knobs and turn the knobs back to cold again and start all over. This actually has an on and off valve right built into the shower head. So what that's gonna do is that's actually gonna keep that hot water up here, and now I'm not gonna have to play the temperature game, where exactly did I want it. Also, for transport, your shower doors have to be closed, and it's got this little latch here to lock these down, so these aren't gonna be opening and swinging around going down the road. For your actual toilet, there are chemicals that you can put in. They make it in a powder form, and they even make these little packets now, just like what you would put in your dishwasher. And typically what you would wanna do is put one of those packets in for every 3 to 4 days that you're actually staying in your camper. and you'll just flush it right down in the tank. And what it does is it's going to deodorize your tank as well as help break everything down. The last thing we have in the bathroom is our sink, kitchen sink. It does have the soap holder here as well as my toothbrush holder, a nice small vanity, and that GFI outlet I was telling you about earlier. The actual fan, it does have a max air cover on it. So you can pull this open, and I can go ahead, and I have settings 1, 2, 3, and 4. Again, 1's the lowest speed.
Okay.
And you can actually use this, too, as a whole house fan. If you want to open those windows up now, you'll actually feel this thing pull air through the actual camper.
Sucking quite a bit of air there, isn't it?
So then I will turn the fan off. I can crank my lid down. And once that's down, I can push up on it, and now it's locked. It's in the lock position. So you can leave this open when you're camping or when you're at home during the season. You can leave that open all the time if you want. With that max air shell on there, even if it rains, it's not going to allow that water to come into the actual camper itself. Okay. Just a way to kind of keep your camper breathing.